Yeah. And it was not the
Hi, everyone. My name is Sheila Sabe, and thank you for being here. Our presentation is It's an Open Source World as We Know It, How Comcast is Embracing Open Source Culture as Well as OpenStack itself. Like I said, my name's Sheila. I'm a community development lead at Comcast. What that means is basically I'm a community manager. Originally, I was working on the OpenStack operations team as an engineer, and about a year ago, I started doing community management work around OpenStack, and now it's mainly all open source communities.
My name is Courtney Ferry. I am a technical account manager at Comcast, and that kind of confuses folks sometimes. I am not an account manager in that I deal with external Comcast customers. Instead, our cloud team performs a as a service delivery to our internal product teams. So my customers are our product teams that are delivering Comcast services and using our cloud infrastructure. And I work with them to help solve technical architectural problems, capacity planning, you name it.
Awesome. So Comcast. Most of you have heard of Comcast, or you may use Comcast, or you have it in your homes. But in case you don't, we are a multi-service operator, global technology software company. Traditionally, we were cable, and now we're moving towards being a majority of technology. Anyway, so we're two brands, Comcast and NBC Universal. We have high-speed internet, video, IP telephony, security and automation for home, as well as media properties and universal parks. Open source, open mindset. As you know, making enterprises, talking to leadership and getting them to shift the way they think, it's pretty challenging sometimes. Lots of times people are used to using traditional vendors and being locked into contracts. But open source is a little bit different. So think outside the box. There are cultural and organizational changes that need to be made. Sometimes you have to go and talk to your senior leadership or send representatives to go and persuade why we should be using these tools or why we should be open sourcing this software that our team just built and building communities around it. And making that process easier for engineers so that they're not battling with legal is really important. So thinking outside the box and making things easier for the company to move towards that direction is really important.
All right. So the next question is why? Or if you want to move towards open source and you need to present this argument to your boss or something, they're going to ask why. Why do we want to move to open source? The first is going to be transparency. Obviously it's open source, everybody can see the code. So this is everybody gets to be on the same page, and you also are able to know who has contributed to the code, and to some people that actually matters. You get to move at a speed that you can control if you are contributing to a product, to a certain bit of code. So there's a feature out there that you don't need or that you need and doesn't exist. Anybody ever asked a vendor to add a feature to a piece of software? And if you're not a Fortune 50 company, it may take quite some time to have that happen, and it still might even if you are. So it's a lot easier if you can just work with your developers, work with the community as a whole, and get the problem solved and put your own effort into it to move at the speed that you need. And that's, again, that gives you that flexibility. It also gives you the flexibility to work on the particular features that you are interested in. I'm a thing ahead on my slide. So I've got an example of that having to do actually with OpenStack. There was a point where IPv6 was not included in OpenStack. I think actually Jonathan was talking about this during the keynote on Monday. He was talking about it being a feature that was added and largely successful. And that was actually a feature that we needed very much at Comcast to be successful. I think you can imagine, we're doing a lot of IP CDN work and that sort of thing. We really need we needed to have IPv6, and we put a lot of resources into working on that as well, and worked a lot with the community, worked a lot with the teams to get that upstream, to get it into a release in time for us to be able to use it to be successful with it. And yeah, that's pretty gosh darn liberating. And all right, the other really cool thing is, okay, it's free. You know, free software is really nice. If you're doing a POC of something and you don't need to spend a lot of licensing, it gives you that flexibility to, you know, play with something new without making an investment. If you really like it, you don't have to turn around and pay for bulk licensing, that sort of thing. Another very important aspect of what we've got open source these days is the common APIs. This allows you to be vendor neutral. You know, we're vendor neutral. If I stand up, you know, if we stand up a cloud somewhere on a particular brand of hardware and get everything set up, you know, we've got our deployments all ready to go, and then 6 months later, we want to stand up another set of infrastructure, and we go to buy the hardware this time, you know, another vendor's got the same specification or specification we like, you know, a little better or something. We're not locked in to using something that only works on that particular vendor, is only approved by them. These common APIs, you'll find that pretty much all of the hardware vendors out there are supporting these ubiquitously. So it helps keep you from being locked in there. From another aspect with the APIs, it also allows you to be platform independent in that you can use, you can build yourself a hybrid cloud more easily. You can use your internal cloud, stick it on OpenStack. Then those APIs are available on public clouds that are out there. It allows you to tailor your workload, you know, own the base and rent the spike, which means put the workload that you know is static on the gear that you own, use that at an effective level of utilization, and then when you've got those spikes when world crises happen or the Olympics or whatever, if you need to be spike out to a public cloud or if you've got a workload that only runs for 2 hours in the middle of the night, you can put those out onto a public cloud and save yourself money for something that doesn't have to live out there all the time. And you don't have to have unused infrastructure sitting around for it, yet you're not having to build something different and use different APIs to direct your workloads to different places. Support. There's a lot of, there's a couple different ways to actually get support on an open source platform. And a lot of people are gonna stand back and they're gonna go, oh, but it's open source, I can't get any support. Well, actually you can. There's a lot of vendors out there that are offering support for these platforms. You've all been down to the marketplace, right? And I hear sometimes, well, that's really a cop-out, then are you really using open source? And yeah, you're still using open source, you're still using the APIs, you're still using the application that, you know, has these codes available that you can actually look at, you can follow the track, you can follow the roadmap of where it's gonna go to help make your plans, you can come and work with the community to help develop features still. You just may not have your own, you know, department of developers that are going to be contributing, or, you know, a giant pile of engineers to help you work on something, because we all know this is complex and challenging. So there are companies that you can get support as a service instead of having to worry about spending all of your money on a bunch of licenses. And then really, what are we all doing for support? It's our community, right? We are all supporting each other. We can jump in IRC and ask a question. Hey, I've got this problem. How do I do this? You use one of the mailing lists. So this community support is something you don't necessarily get with a proprietary product either.
All right, so let's talk about our journey. Back in 2000, we were predominantly just pretty much using open source as a consumer. I'm pretty sure that at that time there was a lot of influencing going on. It was before Courtney and I's time, but in 2006, we were also consuming commercial open source software. By 2017, which is present day, we are consuming, we're leading, we're upstreaming, And we're pretty much trying to lead the path in open source. One example is in 2015, our content delivery network, which is Apache Traffic Control. It was open sourced. And so, you know, we do keynotes, we speak at the conferences, and we build tools. And this is not just necessarily OpenStack related. It's open source all across the company. We use tools such as Ansible, GitHub, a lot of time on GitHub, Terraform, OpenStack, Kubernetes. So we're just basically using a lot of the open source tools. We're trying to get stuff upstream today, and we're trying to do more. So the team that I'm working on is actually open source practice at Comcast, so we're trying to kind of standardize everything and just make it a lot easier to do this kind of stuff.
All right, so that's open source as a whole, our story with just using open source software in general. Okay, so we're at an OpenStack conference. You know, what about OpenStack? So what is, as Comcast, what's our story with OpenStack? How did we get where we are to be, you know, part of the 100,000 core club, right? So 2013, we started off with a proof of concept. We built two regions, and we put it on idle hardware. Read that as old, because, you know, didn't want to put a lot of investment into it and wanted to kick the tires on this. It took us 1 year to decide that this was something that we really wanted to get behind. At that point, we opened up our test environments to our product teams and said, okay, guys, stick some applications on them, see what you can do. And the applications team said, this works, this is great. They enjoyed the flexibility that they then had to start using the tools, and we went all out. We ended up buying, you know, I mean, we made the investment, we bought a lot of hardware, and we got OpenStack into production. When I'm talking about production, when you pull out your remote control and you start pushing buttons to change the station, that remote control talking to set-top box is actually making a call to an application running on an OpenStack cloud that, you know, looks up what show is supposed to be showing on that channel in your market, and then it's talking to another application that is then directing the content, you know, from the video service down to your set-top box. These are applications that are actually running in production on OpenStack today. We're not using it just for our back-end, you know, internal stuff. These are customer-facing bread and butter. What else are we doing? We have built an internal community around OpenStack. So we have these summits here. And everybody, you see how we're benefiting from it, you know, as our larger community. Well, we do internal summits also at Comcast. We try and do two a year as we can. We have our OpenStack team will actually come and talk to, our cloud team will come and talk and let our users know how things are going, what we've got planned. Hey, here's some cool tools we've been working with. The really important thing about this, though, is that then we have our users, our product teams come up and present to all of the other users about what they're doing, what tools they're using, how they're using, you know, OpenStack and how they're using these other open source tools to produce the product. So we've got this community and this sharing and learning going on internally. We also, something else that somewhat mimics the greater community that we do internally, we use Slack, and we have an internal Slack channel called OpenStack, and I looked this morning, it currently has 1,129 people in it, in our internal OpenStack Slack channel. And maybe 20, 30, I don't know, I didn't have it actually counted, but yeah, a handful of them are actually people that work on the cloud team, right? We're all in there. The rest of them are our users, people within the company that are using this application. You know, people that are gung-ho about this, people that have just started and have questions to ask, like, you know, how do I build a VM? I mean, we get people in there doing that, and then we've got other folks in there talking about, you know, how they're tuning their databases. So
Yeah, and just to touch on what Courtney just mentioned, the Slack channel is awesome because I used to be in operations and I would sit there and answer questions. And then once customers started answering other customers' questions, it just became a forum and it's popular and active and people are chatting in there. They talk about their applications, what tools they're using, and it just kind of, you know, became this awesome tool. So we're really happy with it.
We highly recommend it.
Yeah, definitely. So the footprint, so we're in over 30 regions. We have a region being deployed right now as we speak. I think tomorrow?
It's supposed to be done tomorrow.
Tomorrow it'll go live. We're very invested in OpenStack. We've got over 900 projects, and by projects, tenants, that's not necessarily applications. It's just pretty much the tenants that we get requested. So we can talk more later. You guys can see us and we'll talk about some of the, we can dive deeper into the applications that are on the cloud. But yeah, so we've got petabytes of Ceph objects and block storage. Again, if you want numbers, see Courtney and I later. We'd be glad to help, you know, answer some of those questions. And we've got over 20,000 instances.
All right, so one of the things Sheila mentioned earlier is that if you're gonna be doing open source things within your company, not just using open source products, but if you actually want to produce an open source product, you've got to actually give your engineers a path to be able to do it. You've got engineers sitting around saying, wait, I've got this great application. I really want to, you know, upstream it because, or I really want to put it out there because I want other people to contribute to it and help me grow this application and do these, and we want to put it out there because it'll look good for the company. And the engineers are going, you know, I'm sorry, you guys aren't, you know, marketing people. They're not lawyers to understand licensing and that sort of thing. So as a company, you need to actually make a path for your technical people to be able to do these things. So you have to develop a process and let people know what it is. So we've done this. Real high level, our process. You have to give folks some way to actually be able to contact the folks, the smart folks that understand the business rules. For us, you open up a ticket. That way you don't have to go hunting them down, figure out what their email is. You go open up a ticket, and the ticket gets routed off to our open source advisory board. And the folks on the open source advisory board get back to you through the ticket, and then they're gonna set up some talks, and there's gonna be some going back and forth and talking about the application and how it represents the company, and obviously, right, it's a big company. There's gotta be a lot of talks with the business teams. But at least they have a path of finding each other, because you'd be shocked in a large company how challenging that can be if you don't actually set it up and say, hey guys, this is what you do. Once you've got through that, it gets pretty simple. You know, you publish it. Where do you put your code? I don't know, we use GitHub. You can get your PR teams behind it. You can market the fact that, you know, hey, we're great. We've put this out there. The next really important thing, though, if you're actually putting out your own open source, you're open sourcing your own application, is not pushing it out of the nest and going, fly, be free, you know. You need to stay involved, try and build a community around it. The idea of putting it out there is for the application to grow. You want other people to not just use your application, but also to contribute back to it. So other folks using it are going to go, you know, this is great, but if we do this, it can do, you know, a little bit more, and that won't that be amazing? And you end up with OpenStack, right? And that's basically, I mean, that's how you maintain accountability for, you know, the baby bird you pushed out of the nest.
Yeah, and the whole open sourcing process that Courtney just mentioned, it's a work in progress. So if anybody's doing it really efficiently at their company, please let us know. We'd love to talk to you and, you know, figure out how to make the process smooth and an easy transition for our engineers. So how to get people to do it, streamlining the processes, as she just mentioned. Make it easy for your engineers to open source their software or to upstream their work. For example, let's say Courtney has a documentation patch that she wants to put in, and it's, let's just use an example, deployment documentation. It goes to the operations guide. She's been doing this for months. You know, she doesn't need to go through a ticket every single time she wants to put in a patch. Maybe blanket that process for her, make it easier for, you know, the engineers and the developers. Foster inclusiveness, make sure everybody knows that they're welcome to contribute. It's not necessarily, you don't have to necessarily be a Python developer to contribute to OpenStack. There are a lot of many ways that you can contribute, make sure, you know, you spread the word.
Documentation?
Yeah, documentation, work groups, user groups. What else? Do a talk at a summit. I mean, there's a lot of things you can do. Ask that OpenStack, answer questions for people. You can answer questions on the mailing list. You can hang out in IRC. You know, lots and lots of ways. Internal upstream OpenStack training. So what we did is there are a lot of people, they might know Git and Garrett, and they might be developing for many years, but the upstream process with OpenStack is a little bit different. For example, the Git review process, it's different. So make sure that people are all sitting in a room. I know for us, we just sent a calendar invite out, and then I just, you know, trained everybody. And they were so excited to sit in a room, and there was a lot of energy there. People are helping each other, you know, put a patch in, and then especially when the patch goes through, you know, woo! Yay, exciting. So share your milestones. If, let's say, Courtney, for example, she wanted to upstream some code and she got the approval from the open source process, she should probably share those milestones with everybody else so that they know that the process wasn't that bad, maybe. Recognize and reward the achievements and people that are contributing upstream in your company. They're making your company look good, and that's some street cred right there. So make sure that you're recognizing them, rewarding them, send them to summits, give them a raise, I don't know, whatever. Everybody's motivated by different things. So talk to your teams and see what would make them happy. And then oftentimes I ask people, why aren't you upstreaming this? You've just built this awesome tool and the community needs it. They don't have it. You need to upstream this. And they say, oh, I don't have time. You know, oh, I'm so busy. I have no time to do this. Well, include community efforts in their workday. When you're doing your Scrum planning or your Agile planning, put 20% in as a goal for people to do community work. It's really, really important. And then generate reports on community work. So when you're sending stuff over to your senior leadership teams, reports, numbers, I don't know, biweekly, monthly report, whatever it is, include a community, you know, little section with community stuff on there so that they're aware, because this kind of stuff goes a long way.
I'm not telling what Stack Analytics does. All right. So one of the tools that we use for collecting our data on, you know, hey, we're great, we upstream, is Stack Analytics. Anybody can use it. And this is where I get to brag about, you know, how wonderful we are. This is our we brag about ourselves slide. So, 2 years ago, the Vancouver Summit, we'd contributed 36,000 lines of code. Okay, come forward to 2 years. We're at 110,000, a little over 110,000 lines of code contributed to OpenStack at this point. And we've got data to show. So this is nice. You can do this internally. You can, if you're spending a lot of time doing this, you can pull these down for individual users and, you know, go to your boss and say, hey, look, cool stuff, right? And we've got a lot of other stuff in the contribution summary here. But yeah, numbers are good, right? So that's not the only way that you can contribute, though. There are other ways to actually gain recognition within the community for the work that you're doing. One thing that we've been doing locally in Northern Virginia, where I'm currently based, is we host the Northern Virginia OpenStack Meetup Group. It's 2 years old. We've got 600 members in there now. We've had some really impressive speakers. Let's see here, we've had Ben Silverman out. He's the author of OpenStack for Architects. John Dickinson, PTL for Swift, came out, get a talk on Swift encryption for us. And people eat this stuff up, and it's great because we got all of this talking and communicating going on. And it looks good for your company, guys, right? Yeah, I think there I am. There are my shameless plugs.
Yeah, and there's other ways that you can also track the work. Like there's an AUC, so it's an active user contributor. You know, there's just a lot of ways to get all those things tracked. I was going to say that, you know, the 600 numbers seemed really exciting 2 days ago until I talked to Lisa Marie. So shout out to Lisa Marie. She has 6,000, over 6,000 members in her user group, and it's San Francisco Bay Area. So that's awesome.
Oh, and if you're in those areas, look them up. Just get in to meet me and go look up OpenStack, and you'll find a local meetup group. So if you need to, if you want to do more of this locally.
Yeah, and we try to bring users typically to come speak at our meetups so that it's not, you know, sales pitchy the entire time. So we'll have, you know, if we do have a vendor that wants to present, that's great. We allow it, but we'll have another speaker come that's actually a user, an operator, and come do a talk, and then we'll dedicate like 15, 20 minutes at the end for the vendor to do their talk. So, yeah.
I forgot to mention user groups.
No.
You mentioned user groups.
Oh, okay. Yeah, good. All right, so let's go ahead and end with a quote. Free software is a matter of liberty, not price. To understand the concept, you should think of free as in free speech, not as in free beer. So, and that's by Richard Stallman. And I guess we're done, right?
We're doing this. No, Sheila, we're not done. You forgot about the obligatory pet pics. Because we have an adorable golden doodle, Pixel, goes with this one, and my mail order kitty Zuzu, because, you know, you've got to have, whatever. You have to have the obligatory pet pics.
Okay, so feedback. The OpenStack Summit mobile app includes a feedback button on the bottom. We'd love to hear feedback. We'd love, if we suck, let us know. If we were great, let us know. Anything in between, whatever. We'd love to know. So give us feedback if you can. Tell us what you think. And thank you so much for being here.
Appreciate it.